There is a place that is spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen, and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free, and things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Good evening and welcome to another edition of the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. I'm your host, Dave Schrader. Along with me, as always, we have Mr. Tim Dennis, my producer and co-host. Good evening, Tim.
Hey, diddle diddle.
Well, this evening we've got a great show for you. We've got the lovely Miss Lorraine Warren is joining us for her second appearance on our show this evening. And for those of you not familiar with Lorraine, she is a paranormal investigator, best known probably for cases like the Amityville Horror, along with her husband and associate for quite a few years doing this type of investigation. She was one of the first investigators called in on the Amityville Horror case. And last time we talked to Lorraine, we were talking to her about how she and Ed met, and she brought us all the way from the meeting and their background and a little bit of history of their own hauntings all the way up to their first investigation. This evening we're going to invite Lorraine in onto the show. As most of you know, a few weeks ago we lost Ed Warren as well, and Lorraine was kind enough to still come on this evening and share some stories with us and talk to us a little bit more about the paranormal and keep the fires burning. So, Lorraine, thank you very much for joining us on the show this evening.
Welcome.
I appreciate having you back.
Again.
Well, as I said, we left people the last time just kind of wrapping up with the first real investigation that you and Ed had gone out on.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one of the questions that I did have emailed in, and I apologize, my computer is down right now, and I know I'll probably butcher this, but I believe it was from a couple of gentlemen named Hans and Franz out here in Minnesota that are part of a Minnesota ghost.
They're real special.
Yeah, they're neat people. Yeah. And they wanted to know, have you ever seen actual ectoplasm, real slime, like from the Ghostbusters movie? Is that
from
something?
The Ghostbusters movie.
Have you ever actually seen residue?
I have seen spirits materialize.
Okay.
And I have watched things dematerialize. And I have watched exorcisms of individuals. I have really, when it goes into the sensationalism of these Ghostbuster things,
mm-hmm.
It is not really in that manner that we witness it. For instance, I'll give you one example. We were in Borley Church, which is the most haunted church in all of the UK. And we were with a group of researchers, all experienced people. And these particular people that we were with were from the very prestigious Ghost Club of Great Britain and the British Society for Psychic Research. So anyway, there, at least you were with people who had experience and LISAF.
Right.
So Ed was more or less sitting in the first pew of the church. He was sitting there, and he had a bad cold, and the church, it was in the middle of the night, the church was very, very damp and cold. It's an ancient church. Ancient. I mean, it is really ancient.
Okay.
And, but they still have services. They still have services going on there.
So, oh, okay.
Anyway, Ed asked me to ask Harry Price, who was a researcher who had researched this many, many, many years ago. And as a result of it, he documented it into a book. And that intrigued my husband before we ever got involved in research in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
So we knew that when we did get involved in research in the UK, that was one place we were going to be going to do our work, to do our research, to see if we were able to experience it, we were able to document further in this day and age what was going on. So aside from our own people that were with us,
mm-hmm.
and these other professionals, there's more than one thing that's going to happen now. This is the one night. I went up to the altar, I knelt, and I said a prayer in this Anglican church, and then turned and sat on one of the steps coming down from the altar.
Mm-hmm.
And now, remember, Ed is in the first pew, and the others are really just spread around in the church. Everybody is very, very quiet. It is extremely dark.
Okay.
And outside, it's just a lane that's there. There's no traffic.
Mm-hmm.
No traffic at all. Borley Rectory is right directly across the street, but the original Borley Rectory, that had burnt down, and that don't mean that historic hauntings are gone, because many
right.
times they have a way of hanging on or hanging around, I
mm-hmm.
should say. And so that is true of that. So I'm sitting there in the dark, and I asked for Harry Price if there was any way, you know, that he was there and that he could help us in any way. I asked for the very first minister that was to report the phenomena that had occurred in Borley. I asked, you know, him, just
mm-hmm.
like I would be addressing. Say you were addressing a class, look at it that way.
Sure.
And as long as you have your protection, your spiritual protection, and we always make sure of that, that is utmost importance
okay.
to us, is our faith and our spiritual protection. And my head was bowed, and they could see a white beam of light come in through one wall of the church. They could see this. And they commented, and I didn't open my eyes. I kept my head bowed and continued, you know, what I'm talking to Harry Price and
mm-hmm.
this minister. And so as a result of it, they heard what we all heard. Something hit the ancient slate floor.
Hmm.
We heard this. We could definitely hear something hit the slate floor. And then it seems that it started to glow, what they could see, not from the position that I was in,
mm-hmm.
but from the position where they were sitting. They could see this this glow. And then it was, this is the most beautiful thing of all, is to see the Borley Nun. The Borley Nun is a woman who was walled up alive in that church.
Hmm.
There used to be a monastery there, and there was also a convent. And, you know, it is said that there was an affair between a priest and the nun, and as a result of it, she was walled up alive. Well, that is the type of tragedy that can bring about the ghost syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as they watched, and I, at that time, opened my eyes because the flashes were all going off, and of the cameras, and she just glided right down the aisle. I want to tell you, that was incredibly beautiful.
Yeah, it sounds amazing.
That was just absolutely beautiful. And then this, what we heard, this noise, Ed started to come close to me, he tried to come up the step to come close to me.
Mm-hmm.
And he was wearing a trench coat. And you could hear the slap on his leg as he was walking, like on his thigh, right in that area. You could hear it. You could hear it. And he backed off.
Hmm.
And then they watched something that was taking place. They did not understand what was taking place, but they watched. Ed, for some reason, felt that I was in some danger. I didn't think that I was, but he was worried. So he went all the way in the back of the church and put the lights on. And it was one of these old-fashioned things that you have to turn, you know, to put the light on.
Sure.
They're very old-fashioned type of fixture that is doing that. Anyway, what it was a coin. It was an apport, something that had dematerialized at one point and reappeared at another.
Wow.
And it was an 1863 Victorian penny.
Wow.
The rectory was built in 1863. And so it could have been the minister who gave me the apport.
Oh, sure.
But Harry Price was a coin collector.
Oh, really?
So it could have been him.
Hmm.
Now, a few years after that, in fact, I can tell you it was the beginning. Yes, it was around the beginning of 1986. And we were going to be speaking at Dalhousie University in Halifax, Nova Scotia. And so our grandson, who was in grad school at that time, he wanted to join us and drive up there with us.
Mm-hmm.
And he had a girlfriend there that was in medical school that, you know, and they were going to be getting together. So it was very nice because it helped because Ed was recuperating from a heart attack that he had in 85.
Okay.
And this all ties in with this one story, so that's why I want to finish it.
Sure, please do.
And so he came, and when, I'm trying to remember the sequence of how things went. Trying to remember all the sequence, and that's very, very hard without having my notes.
Sure.
You know, in front of me.
Well, you could just give us a ballpark, and, you know, I'm sure it'll fill itself in as you go.
Well, as we lay down on the bed, there was two beds in our room, and Ed laid on one bed, and I laid down on the other. We were exhausted.
Okay.
It was a very trying ride because the weather was horrible, and it was, you know, a bad, bad storm, and it's bitter cold up there. And so we lay down across the bed, and all of a sudden, I looked up, and you know these old buildings, this an old hotel, and over the doors, they have like a window.
Right.
In these dark. Well, it came from there, and I watched this white mist that you're referring as ectoplasmic material.
Mm-hmm.
I watched it come through and follow the ceiling line all the way along. And it was really amazing. And I said, Ed's got a pillow just over his eyes laying there. So he don't know what's going on. And I said, who are you? And what do you want? And I tried to stay very, very, very calm. And so, anyway, I watched, and I said, who are you? And it was Harry Price.
Wow.
And I said, what do you want? And why are you here? And said it was, he went on, I don't want Ed to be as foolish as I after I had my heart attack. And he went on about that, and then he took me to a location, psychically took me to a location.
Mm-hmm.
And this location, I didn't know really where it was, but we were able to document all of it. And he had married a woman of some means, and she had a summer place or another home in Germany. And he took me there, and he had these big boots on, like, what they call them, mukluks.
Okay,
and I
sure.
Had these big boots on, mm-hmm. and there was water there. It was kind of, you know, it looked like maybe it had stormed, and it was kind of swampy right there near this house and his little dog. And I walked with him, and he talked to me a lot about personal issues. And Ed always felt somehow he was always kind of there. There were many aspects of their lives that kind of paralleled.
Okay.
And so then the phone rings, mm-hmm. in our hotel room, and I don't want to stop what I'm doing.
Sure.
And I pick it up, and it's one of the doctors from the university.
Mm-hmm.
And every time that we go there, they have a like a reception for us.
Sure.
And so he was calling about that, and he was calling also about the fact of our introduction, because he was going to be introducing us at our formal presentation we were going to be doing for the whole student body.
Mm-hmm.
And so I shook Ed, I shook him, and I said, please take this call. That's all I said, and I laid right back down again.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other bed, and it continued. And so then I heard Ed hang up with him. I heard him hang up, and then he said, what's the cigar smoke? Or is that pipe smoke? What is that? What's the smoke in here,
mm-hmm.
huh? What's the smoke? And to close it, I said, how do I really know it's you? How do I really know it's you,
right,
Mr. Price? I said it twice.
Mm-hmm.
To him. And he said, watch the papers tomorrow. And I'm trying to remember the name of the seaman. Isn't that awful? That's what I'm forgetting,
mm-hmm.
is the name of the seaman that, and he's telling me this. And so anyway, he closes with me in that way. Then we close. And so I thought, I have to call Dr. Varma back. I didn't want to slight him. I wanted to explain to a certain extent,
sure.
you know, what went on.
Right.
You know, and so,
sorry, I was astral projecting at the time you called, Doctor. We couldn't talk.
I know. So anyway, I said, did you know Harry Price? I said to Dr. Varma, did you know Harry Price? Oh, my goodness, Lorraine. Why did you ask me that? I said, did you know him, Doctor? He said, do you want to know the opening statement for introducing you and Mr. Warren? I said, yes. What do you do if you see a ghost? Quote, Harry Price.
Wow.
So the next morning, Ed really did not feel up to teaching a class.
Mm-hmm.
He just did not feel up to it. And so my grandson said to me, he said, I'll go with you, Graham. I'll go over with you for class. So I went down to have breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And I never noticed this. As many times as we had been at the university, I never noticed that there's a massive, great big, huge painting on the wall in the dining room. And it's the Battle of Trafalgar.
Oh, sure.
And so I thought, wow, my God. So this reporter interviewed me. I told him the story. I told him the name. And so anyway, he wanted to know if he could get permission to cover the formal presentation. I said, I don't know. You're going to have to call the school. I can't give you that permission. And so I went over with Chris to teach. And somebody knocked on the door of the classroom.
Okay.
And Chris opened the door, and he said, I have to speak to Mrs. Warren. I have to speak to her. And the name he gave me the night before
mm-hmm.
was a British seaman who died on the ship coming from Great Britain into Halifax, Nova Scotia,
okay.
where we were.
Sure.
And his obituary was in the paper.
Wow.
And it had just come out. It had just come out that morning.
So that was your sign, huh?
That was the sign that I was communicating. There's been numerous times where
very
ghostly phenomena
sure.
has occurred and communication has been proven out. But the problem with people today is they are constantly looking for proofs, and they are opening doors through Ouija boards and tarot cards and all other crazy means.
You know, that brings up a good point. Why don't we go to a quick break, and we'll come back and we'll talk a little bit more about that, okay?
Mm-hmm.
We'll be right back. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guest this evening is Lorraine Warren. We'll be right back with more right after this.
Don't you dare move. There's more to come from the Darkness on the Edge of Town with Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis.
This is Dave Schrader from the Darkness on the Edge of Town radio show. Each week, we delve into the web of the unknown and deal with a lot of scary subjects. But nothing makes my blood run colder or scares me more than dealing with technology. That's why we turned to the experts when we wanted our website for the show set up and maintained. In the studio with me is Don Raleigh, owner of Evolve Systems. Don and his exceptional staff were easy to work with and made setting up our site a breeze. Don, what is it that sets you apart from other web developers?
Well, Dave, we make your business visions come to life by creating, maintaining, and hosting all of your internet needs. We do this by listening to our clients. We offer programs and price plans to fit any budget. And Dave, I mean any budget. Call us at 651-628-4000 and put us to work for you.
Call Don at Evolve Systems, 651-628-4000. I did, and I couldn't be happier with the results.
That's because we take the ugh out of technology, Dave. Call us today at 651-628-4000 or visit us on the web at www.evolve-systems.com, serving the entire United States. That's Evolve Systems, helping you to manage change. Cheers.
If you read Taspara Mag every month, you'll be able to tell the difference between the absurd.
Could not go to work because Bigfoot stole my car.
And the creepy. Taspara Mag takes you where few would ever go on purpose. From exclusive interviews with the cast of The Ghost Hunters to the latest trends in technology in the field of the paranormal. To join our journey, order at TapsParamag.com.
2006 is here, and for many of you, another year has passed without treating you and your loved ones to a much-needed getaway. Rocky Shores Resort has just what you're looking for. Join owners Jerry and Kim Pip at their family-themed resort that offers a heated outdoor swimming pool, volleyball court, playground, spacious lodge with games and activities for the whole family and more. With 6, 2, and 3-bedroom cabins that are affordable, comfortable, and fully furnished, and 12 seasonal RV sites, Rocky Shores Resorts is perfect for a private escape or for a family reunion. The resorts are located on the east shores of Bowstring Lake in the heart of the Chippewa National Forest. Here you can relax and enjoy nature in the Great North Woods, experience dozens of area attractions, and get hooked on some of the best northern perch, panfish, bass, and walleye fishing in northern Minnesota. Call 1-866-878-0101 to book reservations or check out their website at rockyshoresresort.com for more information. This year, don't ignore the call of the wild. Embrace it and enjoy yourselves. That number again is 1-866-878-0101. Rocky Shores Resort is open year-round. Call today.
Two ghosts walk into a bar and see another ghost at the bar point at them and yell, "Boo!" One of the ghosts yells back, "Boo-hoo!" And the ghost at the bar yells back, "Well, you don't have to cry about it." Ah, hell, you try writing this.
You magnificent bastard! I salute you!
Welcome back to the darkness on the edge of town.
Good evening and welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. I'm your host, Dave Schrader. Along with me, as always, my co-host and producer, Tim Dennis. This evening, our guest is Lorraine Warren. She's a paranormal investigator. She's also a sensitive and is probably most well-known for some of the major cases she's worked on, like the Amityville Horror case. And this is Ms. Warren's second time on our show here. She's talking to us about all the different events that have occurred in her life. And before we were going to the break, she was talking about how people have been opening doors by messing with things like Ouija boards and tarot cards and that. I'd like to get back to that, but I do have one question for you, if you don't mind telling us a little bit, Lorraine. Again, a little bit about your abilities, what you can do, and can you also fill in a lot of people who are not familiar with who Harry Price is as well?
Harry Price was one of the most outstanding researchers of his day. He died about the time that my husband was born, about that time frame. And he was involved in research of some of the most outstanding cases in the UK.
Okay.
And Ed and I became involved in research of the UK in the 70s.
Okay.
So over 30 years ago, mm-hmm. We've been involved that many years over there in some extremely outstanding cases. From the Enfield, England case of two girls that would levitate crisscross in the air. We worked again with the British Society for Psychic Research and the voice phenomena that would occur, and these girls would levitate crisscross in the air, all documented, all on film.
Wow.
And we were involved in that. We were involved in the only case of lycanthropy, animal possession, ever in our career.
Wow.
In over 50 years of research in this subject, that is the only documented case of a werewolf that we were ever able to document. And we worked with the police department over there and became honorary members, and we have our helmets of the police department. Then we became affiliated with University of Edinburgh, which is the most prestigious university in the world in the study of this work and has been given the largest grant ever given, monetarily, largest grant ever given for the study of this work. And we worked with these men, these professors, and two very haunted hotels. And so, but let's go back. Let's go back to the Ouija board.
Yes, please.
So we just have tremendous respect for Harry Price. Harry Price was someone my husband greatly admired and did a lot of research on his work and found him to be a very credible man.
Now, have you used him as a form of spirit guide to help you in a lot of the cases that you've dealt with?
I think Ed really did feel his presence. Yes.
Okay.
And he's probably helping me.
Sure.
You know, I'm sure he is helping me.
Okay.
But right now, I know my husband. I know my husband is with me. It's just a very, very difficult time, Dave, for me.
I understand.
Right
that.
Now, it is extremely difficult. I have not done an interview like this. You're the first one I'm doing it with, and it is very, very, very painful. It's very painful,
I understand, and I appreciate the time that you're taking with us on this.
Yeah, there's so just so many emotions.
Sure.
Yes, we have our faith, and our faith is very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
I took care of my husband 4.5 years, here at our home,
mm-hmm.
and he was stricken 5.5 years ago. And all of these things have their comforts,
mm-hmm.
Your faith and the fact of taking care of someone you love that deeply and on that level. But it does not, you still are on that roller coaster, where you're...
Right. Up one day, down the next, right?
Yeah, you're not in full control of your emotions.
Sure.
You're just not. And so as a result of it, I know that Ed is guiding me, and I know that, he is very much with me. But this incident with the Ouija board happened right here in our own country. This is one of 75% of our cases mm-hmm. involve the Ouija board.
And do you think that's because people, much like yourself at this point, of a point of grieving, are wanting some form of closure, some form of contact, that they're willing to open themselves up to the wrong ways to make these communications?
Well, let me put it this way.
Mm-hmm.
It really isn't. It really isn't that. It's usually people who are looking for kicks.
Right.
That's what it is. They're really looking for proof, and they're looking for kicks. And in this particular case that I'll share with you,
okay,
she was a 19-year-old girl. She had a 15-year-old brother, younger brother, and then she had an older brother in his 20s. The parents, the mother worked for an insurance company, and the father worked for aircraft. And they both worked second shift. So when she was in school, she was in, wait a minute, she was not 19. What am I saying? She was 19. She was 17 years old. She was a senior in high school. And so the older brother was already out of high school. He was like 21.
Okay.
So as a result of this, she would come home every night. She drove her own car to school, and she would come home every night, and she would communicate on the Ouija board with someone that she believed was a friend, a boy. She really believed it. She wasn't, her social life left something to be desired. She didn't really have that much of a social life. She
okay.
wasn't dating,
mm-hmm.
and she wasn't really involved socially outside of the house. So she believed she had this friend, and that he was giving her a lot of answers that she wanted to hear.
Sure.
And she made the mistake, after doing this for a few months, of saying, if you really are who you say you are, show me what you look like. And that was the challenge. That's when she really opened doors.
Okay.
And as a result of it, when I tell you that all hell broke loose in that house, all hell broke loose. That house, in the end, had to be, which was successful, exercised through the Roman Catholic Church.
Wow.
And Ed and I worked on that case. The Catholic priest that was involved with us, he worked on that case along with us. And there was a television show in Hartford, Connecticut, that covered it, never revealing the location of that house.
Sure.
And that was quite a case.
Now, was it just like poltergeist-type activity going on in the house?
The house was totally ruined inside.
Wow.
For instance,
Well, I mean, but I guess what I'm asking, was it unseen forces, or was it
girl
possessed, trashing the place, doing stuff?
No. That was all unseen forces.
Okay.
And, I'll give it to you. I won't give it to you in sequence. I'll tell you the outstanding events of it.
Okay.
We tried to always keep the place manned all day and all night for the family. Because at one time, the family decided that they were all going to go. The husband, the wife, the three kids, and the family dog were going and staying at a hotel, a motel. They were staying at a motel.
Okay.
And things went flying all over that place, caused a lot of damage that they had to pay for. So they went back home again. They went to his mother's house, the grandmother's, and all stuff happened there. So they weren't very welcome there, of course. And so all of these things continued.
Well, could I ask now, a lot of people have the belief that poltergeist activity is nothing more than like an
energy.
Again, energy being released, especially from a pubescent teenage girl that might be going through a lot of stress. So it's not really ghost-like activity. It's more of a PK activity going on that's then kind of lashing out.
Yeah, we witness a lot of that. But you have to realize at one point, in cases like this,
right,
where you have particularly a female girl, more so than boys, that it'll start out through movement of objects. But when they start to be extremely heavy objects, like refrigerators moving out into the middle of the room, like heavy furniture turning over, then you know that that is not the energy of any teenage girl that's bringing all of that about. But something inhuman or diabolical is now attracted because of what is going on. And the law of attraction is always our aura, the supernatural glow that surrounds our physical body.
So these demons or diabolicals almost work like a pedophile or a child molester, in a sense, don't they?
They
look for the weak child that maybe feels alone and unloved, and then says the things that they want to hear and gives them that feeling. And then once it gets entrenched in their life, then it starts wreaking havoc.
Exactly.
Okay.
In so many words, with certain cases. So now, Ed and I, the priest was staying there with the family. Ed and I were speaking at a university. We came there right after we left, and both of us were dead tired. And it's, you know, probably after midnight. And so the husband, the wife, the daughter, and the family dog were all sleeping on the bed, or while laying down on the bed in the master bedroom. And the 15-year-old boy was in a sleeping bag alongside of the bed.
Sure.
And so Ed told him to go with me into the bedroom right next door.
Mm-hmm.
And that had twin beds. And I laid down on the bed closest to the wall. He laid down on the bed that was right near the door. Ed commanded in the name of Jesus Christ for what was there to reveal itself. With that, the bed rose up in the air with my husband, the man of the house, his wife, daughter, and dog all on the bed.
Wow.
With this, the drawers in the bureau kept going in and out so fast that you couldn't even count. I heard the boy next to me, the 15-year-old. I heard him whimpering. I turned very, very slowly over, and I could see a space between the bed and his body. He was hovering right in the air. So many, I'd say maybe 18 inches above the bed. And with that, he was like he was propelled so fast against right against the door casing,
mm-hmm.
which practically knocked him out. And the priest and the father and Ed came and took him out in the kitchen. And so I'm lying there. I'm just lying there. I didn't get up. I didn't want to add to the confusion and all out there. And I just stayed there. And you pray. And I always, always, always pray for everyone I love.
Sure.
That these forces that we're trying as lay people to deal with don't get back at someone I love.
Right.
And, or that we love. So, anyway, I'm doing this. I can hear a baby crying. I can hear nails being pulled away from thick pieces of wood. I can hear all these crazy sounds.
Huh.
There's no baby. There's no nails being pulled. And then I just shut my eyes for a brief moment. And I open them for a minute. And I can see this ghostly form going down the hall. And I say, honey, honey, honey. And the priest answers me. He said, Lorraine, we see it. We see it, Lorraine. And they were in the living room, which was right down the hallway. And Ed commanded in the name of Jesus Christ for what was there to leave. With that, while Ed is doing that, the two fireside chairs on either side of the fireplace, they, I don't know any other way of explaining it, that they walk. The legs, they just keep going.
Right.
And they pinned Ed right into the corner of the living room.
Unreal.
They just pinned him right in. And then I just laid across the bed. And as I laid across the bed, because your emotions are really, you know, running.
Oh, sure.
Crazy.
I would bet, yeah.
With all of this that's going on. And you don't know what is next. And so my eyes are closed, and I hear metal hit wood floors. There was no wood floors. Every floor, even the kitchen and the bathrooms, were all carpeted.
Okay.
The whole house was carpeted.
Huh.
So, but that doesn't matter when they have to project a sound like that.
Right.
And I opened my eyes, and I wanted to tell you, unless you experience it, and not too many people ever have,
mm-hmm.
I watched as those huge, big, flush doors dematerialized in front of me.
Hmm.
And you're in awe. You're really in awe of it.
Sure.
And you're constantly relying on your faith. And within, not minutes, seconds, I hear the priest and the man of the house yell. I hear them yell. Ed was just coming in from the living room through the dining room, but the priest and the father at home were in the kitchen. They had opened the door. The priest wanted the man of the house to go down into the family room and get something for him. And as he opened the door to go down the stairs
mm-hmm.
into the family room, those huge doors that just dematerialized in the bedroom reappeared on that stairway.
Wow.
That all happened through the use of a Ouija board. All
so
of
just
that.
By inviting this kind of terror in.
Yes,
so it's not just a childhood game. It's not something fun
it
to be messed around with or a lark. Even though it's got Parker Brothers' name stamped on it, it's probably not a good idea to mess with a Ouija board.
No, it is not.
Scrying, I think, is the same thing. I mean, do you have the same kind of fears for those events as well?
The what there?
Isn't it called scrying, which is another form of almost like a Ouija board to get them to answer yes or no?
There's so many
pendulum
types of different types of Ouija boards. Anytime that you are conjuring spirits, I don't care how you're doing it, it is super dangerous.
Okay.
And people don't. And the name of that Harry Price gave me, that name, it just came to me, was Cosmos. Cosmos was the seaman's name that came over on that ship from Great Britain.
Oh, okay. From the first story, sure.
And that's the name that was in the obituary.
Wow.
That day.
Well, let me ask you this now. You know, a lot of people, we've got about 10 minutes left with you here. A lot of people have, you know, almost scoffed that you and Ed for so long have said that so many of the things that occur are diabolical or demonic, and they're not just hauntings of, you know, Uncle Ned who won't go away. What is your stand on that? Do you believe in the ghosts of our loved ones that are still haunting, or do you believe that they're
human
diabolicals?
Spirits?
Right.
Oh, my God, of course we believe
good.
Human spirits.
Good, all right. Well, I'm just trying to get clarification, because like I've said, so many people have mentioned for years that it's, with the Warrens, everything is a demon, everything is diabolical, and I don't get that from you. That's why I was asking what your thoughts are.
No, by no means whatsoever.
Okay.
My husband really gained a reputation for his vast knowledge of religious demonology.
Mm-hmm.
He was one of only seven lay people, and he would be called on all over the world for his knowledge of religious demonology by Buddhists, by Muslims, by Jews, by Anglicans, by Church of Scotland, by the Roman Catholic Church. They would say to Ed, by Mormons, they would say to Ed, where did you gain this knowledge? Where did you gain it? You know, and in a way, it was a God-given thing to my husband.
Mm-hmm.
It definitely was. And I'll tell you something that happened to my husband as yet a boy.
Okay.
He didn't have the happiest of childhoods growing up. And as a result of that, he became a person of faith, but he didn't wear it on his sleeve.
Okay.
He didn't go around as any religious fanatic. Never did. Never. Mm-hmm. In a million years did he. Anybody that knew him knew he didn't. He was a joker, kidder, you know, and that's what made him so real to the world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that he could speak on such a serious subject, be so serious, be so knowledgeable. And they would say, where did you gain this knowledge? You have so much knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
My God, I don't know anybody. Catholic priests would say it to him. Rabbis would say it to him. Where did that knowledge come from? And he never, never, never in 27 years of lecturing did not have an answer for people's problems or for questions asked at any university.
Hmm.
Never.
He didn't send away for it with some box tops from cereal to get that knowledge?
No, he did not.
So, that's amazing. So it is a God-given. It's almost like that was his position here. You know, that leads me to wonder, Lorraine, through all the years with all the violence and the diabolical and the throwing and the banging and the kicking and the screaming, did you ever just look at Ed and said, let's just quit, this is crazy?
Never.
Really? You were never afraid for your lives that you made it to the point where you just wanted to be out of it?
We truly, honestly, and sincerely believed that we were doing what God wants us to do.
That's a great answer. Now let me ask you this. That begs a question as well. Ed was approached by Buddhists, by Muslims, by the Jewish faith and everything. Now, if he was approached to help in these cases and Ed came from a Christian background.
He came from a Roman Catholic background.
Right, and he was casting out in the name of Jesus Christ. Didn't that affect the religions that asked for his help? Didn't they realize that once he was able to do
no,
it with
no.
his?
No, 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 no,
okay.
Not really. No,
Well, he didn't go in and cast out the name of Buddha or anything like that, right?
Oh, let's straighten that right out.
Right, that's what I'm asking.
Because, Dave, he was very ecumenical where our work was concerned.
Sure.
He can help, let's use the rabbi. He can help the rabbi to understand what has to be done. He's not going to do it for him.
Oh, okay.
He can tell, and the rabbi is bringing in a minion of 10 pious men from the temple, and they are casting out in their name. We worked when Ed collapsed in 2001. We had just came back from working with Buddhist monks in the mountains of Japan.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful, absolutely beautiful, beautiful people of God, men of God. And we were there. We were there because of Ed's knowledge. During these exorcisms, they were casting out in their faith. Ed, through his knowledge, and me, through discerning, were working together as a team to let them know what was going on.
Oh, okay.
That's how it was handled.
All right. So you did respect the religions of the people who were asking for the help, and it wasn't just... Yeah, because I was always curious about that. If Ed was going in there, I would think, you know, the Muslims or the Jewish faith or the Buddhists
would go,
he said Jesus, and they're gone. Now, maybe we should rethink our religion.
No, dear.
Okay.
No, by no means whatsoever. We were very, very, very ecumenical and had the greatest respect in the world. We would kneel for the blessings of a rabbi, a monk, any religion,
sure,
as quickly as we would kneel for the Roman Catholic priest.
Now, Lorraine,
my husband was buried as the Roman Catholic that we grew up with, were married in, our daughter and grandchildren and great-grandchildren all have been baptized in the faith.
Great. Well, let me ask you this. We've got just 2 minutes left here. If you could impart any little nugget of wisdom to people to protect themselves, what can they do to stay away and stay clear from you know, entering into these diabolicals and entering into the wrong things?
The most important thing they can do is, if they are people of Christian faith, if they are, make sure that these children are baptized. If they are of the Jewish faith, make sure that these children are bar mitzvahed, or where the girls are concerned, it's, now I can't think of that name.
Bat mitzvah.
Oh, that's terrible.
Or bat mitzvah, yep.
Bat mitzvah,
yep.
Yes. And doing that. These are the things that are important, because what happens is this. These people are calling on us for help. What is your religion? What is your religion? Not ours.
Right.
What's yours?
Mm-hmm.
And I used to be a Catholic. I don't practice my faith anymore. I was brought up by Hebrew parents. Where do you turn? Where do you turn? You turn to Ed and Lorraine Warren? No, you have to turn to the church.
That's right.
Ed and Lorraine Warren can go in and document it, but you've got to turn to the church. Turn to your faith. And that is what we tell people to do.
So turn to your faith. Avoid things like, in your opinion, the tarot card, the Ouija board, the scrying, any kind of trying to bring spirits into your world. You should just leave that be. If you have spirits,
any
deal
kind
with
of
that.
Conjuring.
Okay.
Any kind of conjuring. Mm-hmm.
Well, Lorraine, I really appreciate having you back with us on the show this evening, and I appreciate you coming back with us so soon after your husband's passing. And I just want you to know, from the outpouring of emails we've had when we told people that you're going to be on the show this weekend, that you are very loved, very well thought of, and there's a lot of respect for you and Ed. And you know, we're sorry for your loss, and you know, we just thank you very much for all the work that you have done and will continue to do in
thank
his
you.
Name.
Just pray for the soul of my husband.
We certainly will.
And pray for that, you know, I'll continue to be guided to do his work and my own.
Definitely, and we appreciate the work that you've done. And Lorraine, I want to thank you very much, and hopefully we can have you on again here in the future. I'd love to have you talk to us about your werewolf story, and we can talk about a little lycanthropy, because that's something a little different than what people are used to hearing you talk about.
Oh, yes. Great.
Well, thank you very much, Lorraine. Thank you. We appreciate having you on the show.
Thank you, dear.
Thank you.
God bless you and have a wonderful day.
You too, and bless
Bye-bye.
You.
God bless you, honey.
You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. We'd like to thank our guests, Marianne Winkowski, the Ghost Whisperer, for the first hour this evening. Remember, that show kicks off this week. You want to tune in and check it out on Friday night. Also, we want to thank the lovely Lorraine Warren for joining us and giving us a first interview since the passing of her husband, Ed. We appreciate the time she spent with us. We'll be back with more of the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show next week. Make sure to tune in and check it out. And again, tell your friends about Darkness Radio.